Let me know if you can see me. Let me know if I'm here and you can see this and you can hear this, because I don't understand technical things. So I'm watching the chat and awkwardly myself also, which is weird. So yeah, just let me know. I'm gonna try not to fall off my chair again, but it's very difficult for me. So you never know. Okay. Oh, thank you, Cynthia. Oh, good. Yay. You hear me, you see me. Fantastic. Okay. So we've got lots of questions lined up here. And I'm going to sort of go through some of them, but obviously this is a live Q&A, so, you know, type them too and stuff. So first, I'm going to question you. Is that a phrase, question you? Well, anyways, I'm going to ask you questions. So first of all, type where you're from, because I want to know. I know some of you have already said, like, Brazil and Belgium and rainy England. I saw those. But let me know where you're coming from. I am in Arizona, and it's actually really nice here right now, but it was very cold lately, and that's been not fun at all. Woo! Why am I not at GPP? because it's so far away, and I just got back from India. Oh my gosh! Where Harry Potter was filmed? Oh my gosh, I think that I went there actually on a tour once when I was there. I think I saw two Nebraskans. Delhi. Cool. Okay. So let's get started then. If you guys have any questions for me that you can think of right now, then please just feel free to type them in, and I will do my best to answer them as we go. But if not, then I'm just going to start with some questions that I've been collecting on the internet, and I'll get started like that. So let's see. So the first question comes from Megan, and she said, how do you become unstuck with your creativity? How do you know what you're supposed to do next when you're stuck? And I thought that was a really good question, because it's something that I'm sure every single one of us has dealt with on many occasions. And so becoming unstuck, and I love that word, unstuck, because I don't know, it just feels like a more positive way of saying it for some reason. So when I get stuck, which I have been for the last 4 months or so, kind of not stuck, but in a creative rut or in a creative transition, I guess is the better word for it, then I find that I'm most often turning to something different, something entirely outside of my comfort zone to, you know, just sort of move forward in a different way and not put any pressure on myself. My biggest problem with being stuck or trying to get unstuck is that I feel a sort of pressure from people who look at my photography, from myself wanting to be better, from, you know, my mom calling me to say things like, when are you going to release a new picture? When are you going to release a new video? When? And I think that we kind of get trapped in this when cycle of, when is this going to happen? When is that going to happen? When there is really no timeline to this whatsoever. So for me, becoming unstuck is all about finding a balance between trying something new and taking the pressure off of when I'm going to produce something good, which I think is something that we can't really, you know, put a rating on, I guess. So my unstuckness, I'm making up totally new words now. My unstuckness is all about trying something new, going through storytelling exercises that I absolutely love, that just get my mind thinking in a bit of a different way. And aside from that, sometimes it's even about going back to the beginning, like going back to images that I was very first compelled to create when I picked up my camera for the first time. And I think that that can be really refreshing. So I'm going to take a second and just scroll through some questions here that are being sent in. And I'm so thrilled that you guys are sending questions in. So thank you, thank you, thank you for that. Okay, so first question here is, what is your typical day like and how do you organize your routine? And I actually love questions like this because I think that routine is one of the most important things to my workflow that there ever can be. And I travel a lot, so I'm also sort of breaking that routine constantly. But even when I travel, I have a certain routine that I always stick to. And my routine is very often that I like to wake up early. I usually just get up with the sun whenever that is. You know, in the summer, it's much earlier than right now. And right now, it's about 6:30 or so. And I take that time for myself because I'm definitely a morning person, super productive in the morning. And so I really sort of make sure that I go to bed at a decent early time and that I wake up at an early time. I always start my day with a little guided meditation or storytelling where I'm really thinking about what kind of stories am I interested in today and how can I stretch my imagination. I get online, I do social media, I answer emails. I make sure every day, you know, my goal is to have inbox zero. So I'm making sure that I'm answering emails as much as possible in the morning time because I know that I'm about to lose my motivation to do anything like that later on. So I work on the computer until about noon and then usually I start to get restless. So maybe I'll edit a picture, go out on a photo shoot, just do something fun and creative. I do a lot of cooking, a lot. So I spend usually 1 to 2 hours a day cooking and I like to watch Doctor Who and Game of Thrones and I love watching little TV things at the end of the day, doing yoga. And lately I've been practicing the piano and also the guitar. So that's been really fun and exciting too. Okay, next question. So let's see, when you were first looking for representation from galleries, what was the most effective way of approaching them? So that's a great business question. And I'm going to absolutely answer that because I don't want anybody to make the same mistakes that I've made, trust me. And so, when I started approaching galleries, it was very much like everything that you never, ever, ever want to do when you're approaching anybody, which is to not think enough about how I actually fit into that gallery and how I can, I suppose, you know, best represent myself to them. So I started emailing every single gallery that I could, no matter what type of art that they took, no matter what. I sent all those emails in the to line, just one generic email, and I didn't really hear anything back except for negative responses. So because of that, and what I learned from that experience, I started only emailing galleries that took the work that I produced, things that were maybe conceptual in nature, surreal, photography galleries, things like that. And I started catering my email to them specifically, saying things like, all right, well, I love your gallery space. I love this artist that you represent. And just letting them know that I put a personal touch into it. So I started to do that and that was really helpful. And I started getting much more positive responses back. I started doing tiny little shows, like, you know, a big group show where I just had one piece in it. And because I was doing that, I started building my resume up until I had a CV that was big enough to send to larger galleries. So that was kind of my approach. And that's what I encourage other people to do as well, is to have a portfolio of at least 10 images that you feel really good about showing in a gallery, and then approaching them with your website, whatever guidelines they might have. Okay. How many photos do you aim to create in a week? So this has changed drastically for me. When I started photography, my whole first year was like I was taking a picture every day, at least one picture, sometimes two. I was creating, gosh, I mean, probably more than that. So I would say I was creating about 10 images a week. And that was my whole first year. And I got really burnt out with just the effort that it took, all the free time, because I was also working, you know, a 9-to-5 job. And I was editing when I could and shooting when I could and waking up really early. And I started to feel pressure from myself and other people to really produce. And I was ignoring the fact that the quality of the work really mattered as well. That's not to say that I'm not proud of the works that I created from that first year, but simply that it just wasn't thought about enough, I suppose. So now, I sort of slowed down. Every year I slow down a little bit more, and now I'm producing, like, for example, I've made one picture this whole last month. I'm about to finish my second picture, and I think by the end of February I will have maybe 4 or 5 images. So, it just depends on your workflow, and I don't think really that the answer to that question matters in as far as how you create. So, hopefully that helps. Okay. Okay, I'm not gonna talk about my hair right now, but everybody should be rocking the braids if possible. Okay. So, question, what do you do when people talk poorly about an image, and how do you keep a positive attitude? I do have people, say bad things about my pictures, and that's totally okay because, see, here's the thing. I'm sort of like a 0 to 10 on both ends of the spectrum on the scale of sensitivity. When it comes to somebody saying something bad about my artwork, I care 0%, like not at all. And if somebody's trying to attack my character, then I care a lot. And I really want to be a good person, and I don't want people to, think badly of me as a person. But if they think badly about my art, then I feel like it's totally fine because it's just art, you know? I mean, I know that we put a lot of ourselves into it, and I know for me that my art is personal on a lot of occasions. But at the same time, because somebody doesn't connect with something, that doesn't mean that your art is bad. That doesn't mean that you should have done something different or something better. I mean, it could mean anything. It could be that your piece of art triggered an emotional response that they weren't expecting, and therefore they're reacting negatively. It could be that they just don't like that type of art, that they just simply, I don't know, just they don't care for it. And that's fine too, because I'm not going to create something that everybody likes. If I did, and maybe I would be able to sell a lot. Maybe I would be a commercially successful artist, but it wouldn't be what I'm trying to express. So I tend to just think, you know what? If somebody doesn't like it, then good, because at least I created something that somebody cares about, good or bad, because all of that is important in art. I think that we've sort of come into this mindset, especially with the internet and sharing images so often, that we have to produce something that everybody likes, when in fact, art is meant to create a conversation, isn't it? So I think it's kind of a good thing when somebody doesn't like what I do. And I just try to be really nice about it, as kind as possible, and understand that I'll never know what they're going through in that moment in their lives that caused them to be maybe negative or say something in maybe a harsh way. Okay, so, okay, next question. How do you get people to buy your work? Oh gosh, that's a hard question. And finding models to work with them. So, getting people to buy your work, I still have no idea, to be honest. I mean, I wish that I had a better idea. I guess I have a little bit of an idea. But I realized that I was putting my work online a lot, and people were emailing me to ask if they could buy prints. And I just wasn't really making any sales. And you might have maybe experienced this, if me, I don't know, you might not have, but if you have, maybe putting something on Redbubble or one of those online sites where you can sell prints like through the internet. And I found that when I tried that approach in my first year, and when I tried just selling myself, I just wasn't getting a lot of traffic from people who are willing to purchase those prints at like a price more than, say, $15. And that's fine if that's how you want to sell your work. You just have to sell a lot of it to be able to make a living doing that. So it's just a totally different pricing structure to what I've decided to move forward with. So I really rely on galleries to sell my work, and not only galleries, but going to art fairs and different events where your art is being shown, like in a really concentrated zone where maybe there's an exhibition, or at an art fair, there are 50 galleries showing work, and all the art collectors go there to go find the work that they're going to buy. So I'm really relying on galleries to be able to do that. But I also sell my work in other capacities. For example, Licensing. I license for book covers and album art and things like that. So that's something that I'm reaching out on my own to different bands sometimes, to publishing companies, and then in turn they're reaching out to me, often because I made that first step. And finding models, I don't work with models in a traditional sense where I'm going to an agency and I'm trying to, you know, get a model to come work with me and doing contracts and stuff like that way. So instead, I would say lately, like in the last year or two, about 80% of my work has been self-portraiture. And when it's not, it's usually just my friends, because I'm just looking for somebody who can adequately portray a character, not so much look modelly or know how to pose their body or anything like that, because I'm doing that for them to put them in a storytelling pose. So I'm working with friends a lot. I use Model Mayhem, which I think is a great site for finding models. I've never really had a bad experience on there, but I know a lot of people have. So I use Model Mayhem. And then outside of that, I just ask on the internet who wants to, you know, have their picture taken in a very uncomfortable position, perhaps in a very uncomfortable environment. And then somebody usually responds somehow. Okay. Oh, no, I lost my spot. Okay, I'm looking. Oh, geez. I totally lost my spot, but don't worry, I'm going to find it. Or I'm not going to find it, in which case I apologize. Oh wait, I found it. No, I didn't find it.
How do you know when your photographs are finished and good enough? I feel like my photographs are completely done retouching.
Thank you. Okay. So how do you know when your pictures are finished? How do you know when they are done being retouched? So I have this process that largely I'm creating before I ever pick up a camera. And I'll show you my little book here, which I mostly just wanted to show you because it entirely matches my dress, because I got them at the same store in India recently. But anyways, so usually I will create a little sketch, and I'm doing that now, but you can't see me. And that sketch will be sort of like the frame that I have for my camera, which for me is a square. And then I'll start to draw. Like, let's say, okay, I want hills. And maybe there's going to be a string with a big circle attached. And then maybe I'll be sitting here in the string and there'll be fog in the background. So that's kind of where I start, and I make sure as I'm doing that to write out every little detail. Like, okay, the dress is going to be this color, the background's going to have a yellow tint, the angle's going to be low, there's going to be this type of texture on it. And once I start preparing like that, really just figuring out, okay, this is how I'm going to do it, this is how it's going to look, then suddenly in editing, I usually reach a point where it looks like how I planned it to be. And when it does, I know that I'm finished. And there are times when it isn't that planned out, where I just don't know. And in that case, it takes me longer. And usually I'll spend a whole week with it up on my computer, and I'll keep coming back and I'll keep coming back to see what feels right. And sometimes I send it to other people for critique. But the funny thing is that I think my friends all laugh at me a lot, because when I send them sort of an image for critique, sometimes they'll say something and it's totally valid and I love that they've given their input, and then I just totally ignore it. And it's sort of like when you're trying to figure out what restaurant to go to, and you're saying to yourself, okay, do I want Mexican or Chinese? Which one should I go to today? And you're thinking and thinking, and then finally you say to your friend, should I go for Mexican or Chinese? And they say Mexican, and then you're like, nope, I definitely want Chinese, because you already knew what you wanted. So that's kind of how I use my friends as a bounce board sometimes too. Okay. Let's see. Will you ever come to England for workshops? Absolutely. I come every year, and I don't know if I'm coming this year. It's unlikely, because I'm trying to cut back a little bit on traveling, but I really want to, because it's one of my favorite places. Okay, next question. I'm just going really fast to try to get as many answered as possible. When did photography become your main job or source of making money, and how would you encourage others to make this step? Okay, that's a really good question. And I started my business personally in February 2010. So, I'm celebrating, I guess, right now, my 6-year photo business anniversary. But my friend Kelly sitting next to me, you just can't see her, and she's always making fun of me for having too many anniversaries to celebrate because I celebrate everything. So maybe I'm not celebrating. But so I started then, and I started, a lot of people would say prematurely, because I was working a full-time job, and I kind of had that like straight out of college blind confidence thing going on, because I was, I had a job and it was a great job, and I hated it, but it was a great job. And I got my first gallery show. And because I had my first gallery show, I suddenly realized, oh my gosh, I could do this full time. Like, I could be a photographer, even though that's not really the case. Like, just because you have a gallery show doesn't mean you're going to make lots of money by, you know, having your work up there on the walls. So I decided that I was going to quit my job, become a full-time photographer, and that's what I was going to do. So that's when I did it. And for the first year, I really didn't have an income from it. I decided that I wanted three things. I wanted to sell my prints in galleries. I wanted to write a book and publish that book. And I wanted to teach workshops, because from the time I was very little, I wanted to be a teacher. And that was always my thing. Like, I was going to be an English teacher. And so I thought, well, I'm not teaching English, but I can maybe teach photography. So I started doing that. And that was really good. And I wrote my first book and I self-published it. And then I started to have lots and lots and lots of shows, which I lost money on that year. But after that, once I sort of defined my goals of what I wanted to be doing with my time and where I wanted my images to go and pricing and stuff like that, it took about a year for that market to really pick up, for me to get a gallery that represented my work, for me to start to actually write a book that was going to be with a publisher, and to start traveling a little bit more, doing speaking engagements and things like that. So that's when I started to make money off of photography, was probably early 2011 was really the time that that picked up. So if you're thinking about making that step into being a full-time artist, you know, you have to know that it's going to be up and down, because it's hard to find a regular income source for something like that. But it's also good to have very clearly defined goals with very clearly defined methods of achieving those goals. And I think that this is where a lot of people stop the planning. It's so easy to say, oh my gosh, I have this big dream and I would love to make this happen. And then that becomes your career goal. But if you don't write out the 10 different steps that it's going to take to do that, then suddenly you're skipping things that you have to do, or you're not doing anything because you don't know where to start. So I just try to be really clear about those goals. And also be realistic about, is my portfolio ready to, you know, be a professional? Is it ready to approach this gallery? A great example of this is how there's a gallery that I really love that I was thinking about approaching with my work. And I stopped myself and I said, I'm not ready for that. You know, I feel like maybe next year, once I finish this new body of work that I'm working on, maybe then I'll approach them, because maybe then I will be ready with this work to present to them. But right now, with what I currently have, I don't feel prepared. So it's all about timing too, and knowing when you're ready. Okay, let's see.
Where do you get all your inspiration from, and how do you translate it into your photography?
Okay, so inspiration, where does it come from? I believe very firmly that we all have a certain way of seeing the world, that there's something in each of us that allows us to stand out from somebody else, the person right next to you, the person who typed right above you, whatever it might be. And so I think that you just have to dig and search within yourself to find that thing that makes you see the world differently. And it could be a certain experience. It could be the way that you've reacted to an experience. It could be a personality trait that isn't very common, or something that just makes you feel the most like you. So for example, I have certain character traits that don't translate into my work. Like I'm very stubborn. I'm very driven. Those things don't translate into my photography, but I have other things that inspire me about my life. For example, the way that I look at death has always been inspiring to me and something that I recognized at an early age set me apart from other people. So I started to explore that theme in my life and explore how that could translate into a photograph or into a film or into a piece of writing. And so I think that it's just all about finding that one source, the thing that makes you feel most like you and it separates you from other people. And once you find that, then you can always find inspiration because there's always that thing to draw on to figure out new ways of representing that. Okay. So next question, what advice would you give a person who loves photography but is afraid to step out of their comfort zone? Now, I think that, well, I mean, to be honest, I am you. Like, I have been you for the last 7 years. And I think that my problem has been that I started creating one thing. And once I began creating that thing, I sort of forgot that I could do anything else. And not only forgot, but felt afraid to, because I thought, you know, that you would not like it. And I think that we all struggle with that, no matter how like professional somebody seems or how confident somebody seems. There's always that nagging feeling in the back of your mind of, but this person already liked what I did, so will they like this other thing? And it's just a matter of saying, who cares if they like that other thing? Who cares if this fails? Really, who cares other than you? You care the most. So I started, I guess a few years ago, I decided I was going to do fashion photography. Just try it. Not do it, but try it. And I was terrified to reach out to a designer and a model and all those different people that needed to come together on that shoot. And I was afraid of letting them down. Oh, they're not going to like this. They're going to think it was a waste of time. They're going to do this, this, and this. When in fact, it was just me who was scared and they didn't really care all that much. They didn't care if they got great pictures from it. They just wanted to collaborate. So I think that setting expectations for yourself when you're about to do something new is really important, because when you set the expectation of saying, I don't expect anything from myself, I just want to try something new. My only expectation is to produce something that I've never produced before. And then setting other people's expectations to say, I don't know what I'm doing, I'm just trying to do something new and different, I don't know what it'll be like, then suddenly there is no pressure and you feel that comfort to be able to step out of that zone. So I'm doing a new series right now. It's a brand new photo series. It's a bit different. It's much more labor intensive, very quiet in a sense. And I think nobody's going to care. Like, that's what my brain is telling me. My brain is saying nobody will care about this. But I have to really, I think, just let that go. You know, just say, you know what? Who cares if nobody cares? Who cares? I'm still doing it because I love it, so it's already a success. And I think that's easier said than done. I mean, it took me months and months to start a new series and to really jump in and just go for it. And not only that, but to stop creating the work that I'm used to and to start doing something new. So give it time. Okay, let's see. I love, so I'm like scrolling through the chat in a totally delayed fashion, and I love that you guys like Doctor Who too, so that's really nice. And yoga, one for yoga. Okay, do you ever find yourself comparing your work to others and feeling inadequate to other people's works? And if so, how do you overcome that and become confident in the work you do? So yes, I tend to not follow a lot of people online for this very reason, because I know that the first thing that I'll do is compare myself to them. There are people that I love to follow because they're so different, and there are people that I love to follow because I do like their work and I just need to check in periodically instead of seeing it sort of bombarded in my newsfeed all the time, because that does bring me down a bit. So I do compare myself to others, and it's something that I've been working on forever. I mean, since as long as I can remember. But I don't ever think that my work is less because their work is so great. And so that's something, a distinction to make, that just because you love what somebody else does, that doesn't mean that what you do is any less, even if it's different. I remember looking at the work of Gregory Crudson. A lot of you guys may know him, and he does these huge, big setups, like you know, have shut down a town street for like 2 weeks and then, you know, reconfigure the traffic lights and just all these amazing things. And I remember thinking, I'm never going to be able to create like he does. I'm never going to be able to shut down a street in a town. I'm never going to have such a big set or understand lighting like he does or set design. And then I started to realize that, yes, I might never do those things. But one, that's because that wasn't my vision. And two, that's him. It's not me. It's not what I want to be doing. And just because I haven't done that doesn't mean that what I've done is any less valuable. And I've done something on my own. And maybe, you know, this person that we admire so much wishes they could do something like that or wishes that their work would look more like that. So I think that it's a double-edged sword. You, yes, you're pining after these people that create these amazing photographs, but at the same time, somebody might be doing that to you and you have no idea. So I think that the best we can do is, you know, moderate what you see online a little bit better so then it's not a constant bombardment every single day of images that you feel like you need to, you know, live up to that standard, but also realizing that your work is no less because somebody else's work is great. Okay. How do you know when you're ready to display in a gallery? So I think that, and I touched on this just briefly already, and that is that I believe that you should have a portfolio of at least 10 images and more like 20 to 30 that you feel really good about that you can present to a gallery. I think that you should have a series done, something where the images are connected in some way where they might show really well together. And I think that you need to really understand what your artist statement is, like really what your mission is in creating your artwork. If you know why you create, that's very appealing to a gallery because they want to be able to tell their clients, this is how this artist works, technically, creatively, with inspiration, etc. So once you have those things, once you have the know-how, like you've got your technique down, you've got the why down of why you create, you've got at least 10, preferably 20 to 30 images in your portfolio that you feel good about, and you've thought about how you're going to print, how you're going to price, that is a really awesome time to put your work in a gallery. If you feel like, you know, you're technically there, there aren't any glaring editing mistakes or anything like that, like there's a real message, go for it. And of course, you can always submit anytime, and a gallery will say no if they don't want it, or they'll give you a critique if you want that, or they'll say yes, and you never know. So I think that that's when I personally feel that I'm ready to approach a gallery. Okay. Let's see. You seem to have a very good process and workflow. Thank you. Has it been something you've been able to do all your life, or did you have to learn how to keep focus on your work? That is definitely a defining feature of mine. I'm very, very, very focused and like good at just getting things done in the order that they need to be done in, except when it comes to emails, in which case they always come last. But yeah, I've always had a sense that I work better with a workflow, like where I have a schedule to keep to. And I've always been like that. I mean, I really liked going to high school and stuff because I liked having that structure, and I really liked college because of that. And then when I started my own business, I realized I was never going to get anything done if I didn't have a schedule for myself. So whether it's, you know, Photoshop workflow or just being in my office doing business work or something like that, I always like to be very sort of structured. Okay, so so what is it to leave your 9-to-5 job and be a full-time photographer? What things did you do before quitting the job? So when I was working before I was a photographer, I first worked at a production company in the film business in Los Angeles as a receptionist. And that was a very easy job, and I really liked it because I had lots of free time. And then after that, I was working as a legal assistant, which was a fantastic job to have to save money and learn about the legal business and, you know, read contracts and understand contracts and stuff like that. But it ate away at my soul very slowly, actually very quickly, and then just it continued just eating my soul. It's a good visual. And so I decided then that there was just, I couldn't stay there, that it really was just killing my insides. And so that's when I started to do a few things. One is what we just talked about with the gallery, with you know, knowing when you're ready and what to have prepared. So I started getting a show together. I started to create a series. I started to print my work and understand how to price it. I started to define my goals. I started to put that out there on social media, sort of cultivate a community and see who would be interested in different types of things that could bring in money. And I'm totally open about talking about stuff like this. So hopefully I don't sound aggressive or anything, but So I just put it out there and said, I'm not going to do these other photo things that people make money at because I'm not interested in that. And I don't want to kill photography for myself. Like, I don't ever want to feel like it's a chore. So instead, I went ahead with pursuing my goals. And then eventually, when I had a little bit of money saved up, I did quit my job. And that was about a year into my photography hobby, I would say. Okay. What other practitioners, photographers, or otherwise deeply inspire you? Not necessarily inspire your work aesthetically or conceptually, but more who are people whose work you just adore? So I mentioned Gregory Crudson. He is a photographer who I think is just phenomenal and amazing and wonderful. Julia Fullerton Batten is awesome. Maybe I'll type these as I go, which I'm definitely going to lose my spot here, but we'll deal with time. Okay, so Gregory Crudson, Julia Fullerton Batten. I love Tom Chambers and Jamie Baldridge. And those are some photographers that I love. And then, let's see, as far as other people though, I love any sort of classic paintings, especially Pre-Raphaelite paintings, because of the colors and just the way that the paint was applied. I don't know anything about painting, so I can't really like speak to technique, but I just love the way that it looks so soft and ethereal, and I think that's really beautiful. So so I love Pre-Raphaelite. Oh, that's spelled super wrong. Okay, well, it's done. So correct my spelling. And I love Elizabeth Gilbert, one of my favorite people on the planet, because she's so inspiring and awesome and wonderful. She has a new book out called Big Magic, which I think is really great. So she's one of my favorite people. Here's a photographer that I've become kind of obsessed with. I hope you're watching, Samantha. Samantha, I don't know how to say your last name. Gibble? I don't know. Oh gosh, I should have asked you. But I've become really obsessed with your photography, and I think that your journey is amazing. So, So that is just a few people who I've been really touched by lately. Let's see. I'm gonna just pick a random spot to start.
Can you talk about your work with publishers and being involved with book covers?
Yes. Okay. So my work with publishers and being involved in book covers. So the way that I actually started with book covers was, first I went looking for an agency online, that like a stock agency, and I signed up with one of those, and that produced like a couple little tiny things, and I realized that I was just one of way too many photographers in this sea of stock images that I wasn't really getting any attention. So I started reaching out to really small publishing companies, like there's this tiny publishing company in Illinois that I wrote to, and they don't do a lot of books, but they do some, and they have low budgets, and I offered my work for free. And I just said, if you ever think that you can use an image of mine on a cover, go for it. And I'm not saying give your work away for free. Trust me. It was just the decision that I made in that moment. And so I did a book cover for them, and little did I know, they actually work with bigger publishing companies, and then those companies work with other publishing companies. And so it was by reaching out to tiny publishing companies who had bigger contacts that I was able to start doing book covers for Penguin and HarperCollins and people like that. And I don't do a lot of them, but I really enjoy it when I do. So that's how I got started working with publishing and doing book covers and things of that nature. Okay. Here's just going with that stock question. Is it okay to use stock images in combination with your own photos when creating an art piece? Yes, if you pay for it. And I think that's just a big distinction that has to be made. I have purchased stock images in the past, and I have I've used them and sold those images, but I've paid for them. Like, I've paid for the right to use that image in my artwork and sell it. So I never just go to Google, download an image, use a little piece of it, and hope nobody notices, because I guarantee you somebody's gonna notice eventually. I mean, maybe not, I shouldn't have said guarantee, but in my mind, it's going to happen. So I'm not even ever going to take that step. Plus, I just respect artists and I want to give credit where it's due, and I want to pay people when they deserve to be paid. So yeah, it's fine if you pay for the work and you have that explicit license.
With the approach to this new series, it sounds like you're challenging yourself creatively. What are those challenges and what are you doing to overcome them?
Cool. Okay, so the question was, with this new series that I'm doing, it sounds like I'm challenging myself creatively. So what are the challenges that are being presented, basically? And that is definitely true. And so, I wanna show you something, but I don't know if I have anything to show you. So let me kind of search real quick here. I'm going to just show you some maybe behind the scenes things in this new project that I've been doing. There might be something entirely inappropriate in this, but let's just try something. I'm going to share my screen. So let me know if you guys can see this. Okay. So I know there's a slight delay, so just let me know if you can see what's going on here. Probably not. Hold on. Wait. It's gonna work. Don't leave me. Am I still there? Okay. Ah! Okay, so let me know if you guys can see this. How are we doing? Can you see it yet? Oh. Okay, it's coming. Yay, okay. So these are just some pictures of my new series, like the production of it. So I started by building a room. And let me just scroll through some of these pictures. So I'm building a room and it's like a really big room. am I doing a really great job explaining this, you guys? So here's another image. Of the construction, and it's the first time that I ever did anything that was physical. Like, I'm not one to build things, like building props, making costumes, stuff like that. So that's a real stretch for me because I'm just really bad at it. So this is the room that I started building with Kelly, who's sitting next to me, and another friend. And I even did fun things like this where I was cutting crown molding and painting and screwing and nailing and just everything. Let's see. And then eventually it got to the point where we painted and I set up a ladder and I started shooting from the ceiling looking down. So I attached a camera slider, which is a video thing. It's like a video slider for your camera. I attached that to the ceiling so that I could mount my camera to the ceiling and have it maneuver back and forth on the ceiling. And so the whole series will be shot looking down into this room that you see. I started sewing my hand, which I didn't use, you know, for myself for the actual thing. But this was just practice to let my sister-in-law do it because she was the model eventually. So, okay, I'm going to stop screen sharing. Hopefully you guys could see that. Okay. Cool. All right. Okay. Good. So, okay, good. You saw. Good. I wasn't sure until I got back to my chat here. Yes, Home Depot. all right. So, thank you for saying yes so many times. That makes me feel good. All right, so you did see, and now I'm going back to the questions. So anyways, that is the series that I'm working on. It's very challenging for me personally. It's just really labor intensive, and I've never worked so slowly before. Like I started building this in mid-December or so, and just finished in mid-January actually constructing the room and all of that, and I did my first shoot then, which was very exciting, and involved so much yarn, I can't even tell you. So Kelly, who's sitting next to me, was helping me. Can you just wave over here? No. You're not in yet, are you? Oh, oh, you are. Okay, sorry. Okay. Sorry, we're watching on the delay. Ignore me, I'm being silly. So what was I talking about?
Building.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Okay. So yeah. So Kelly and I were yarning this room. Like we were literally laying down strand by strand of yarn in a circular pattern in this whole 7 foot by 7 foot room. And it was so difficult, like unexpectedly difficult. It was physically challenging to do, to be hunched over and laying this yarn down. And she said after a 5 hour stint of it, that it was like the hardest physical thing she's ever had to do ever. And that it was very emotionally trying. and so it sounds really funny, but that's been kind of like the joy of it is like doing something physical, getting in there and actually physically building something and not relying on Photoshop, even though I love Photoshop and I'm still, you know, doing some things in Photoshop to the image. I felt for the concept of what this series is, it was very important to actually have the model immersed in this space for reasons that I'll probably share later when it makes more sense. So
what did you mount your camera on for above angle shots?
What did I mount my camera on for above angle shots? So there's this thing called a slider, which isn't what I mounted it to exactly, but there's a slider. It's just like a long bar and mine is 5 feet long. And so that has screw holes in it. So I held that up, put it on the ceiling, and screwed that in so then it was secure. And then I got a ball head tripod attachment. I think it was a Manfrotto, but I'm not sure. Do you remember?
It is
Manfrotto. And so that is just an attachment that would literally, like, if this is your tripod, then it would sit right on top of it and have a ball head that's like movable in any direction. So I put that onto the slider, mounted it onto the slider, and then I was able to put my camera on that so then I could tilt it so it pointed down. Very convoluted, but that's what it was. So that was really fun to try. I mean, it took a lot of trial and error, and it was like we were yelling and screaming as we were doing it because we thought that my camera and the slider and everything was going to fall down on us, and we were on top of a 12-foot ladder, but it worked out. So, good.
Is your focus point where the eyes of the model are, or do you use the center point and refocus?
Okay, so the question was, is your focal point typically when you shoot on the eyes of the model, or do you use the center point of focus and then what's it called? Focus and then move back to composition. I don't know what that is. Does that have a name? Probably not. I don't know. So anyways, I actually don't usually think about focus that technically. Like I aim to get some part of the body in focus. And then if it is, I call that a success. So for most of my images, I'm not worried about, are the eyes in focus, you know, where exactly is the focal point? Because most of the time I don't even see the eyes of the subject. So if I don't see the eyes, then it just doesn't matter to me. So I just make sure that most of the subject is in focus for whatever shot it is. And yeah, usually that works out really well. So at least for the style of work that I do. I'm also usually shooting on a tripod, so I don't have a lot of room to focus and then recompose. So I actually use Zeiss lenses, and oh, I have it right here. And so like this one, for example, is a manual focus lens. But it works really great because it shows digitally on here what the focal point is. So you can kind of see that. If I don't know, if, hopefully you can. We'll put it really close. So you can see that just moving there. And so that's really helpful because specifically in this new series that I'm doing, we measured the distance from the camera down to the subject, and then I could literally just put on the number, like set the meter number to what it should be based on the distance of my subject to the camera. So that's how I work sometimes as well. Okay. Any more questions? So let's see. I might not be able to, I'm never going to find where I stopped. So I'm just going to pick one. Okay, so here's a question about editing. How do you make a winter setting or any setting lacking color or detail more interesting? I like that question because that's kind of like our situation, right? Like no matter where we live, we very often say that we don't have any good shooting locations because either we're so used to them or we really don't have a lot of diversity where we are. So I think it's really important to be able to create an interesting background no matter what the actual background is. So I have a couple of methods that I use, and maybe I'll be able to open Photoshop or something and just take a quick look at something here and maybe just go through maybe my like top three editing tips for something like that maybe. But let me know if you're interested in that, because if not, then I will move on and I will not open a picture. So just let me know. And in the meantime, I'll just take a quick look on my desktop to see what I have here. Let's see. I have no idea what I have. Okay, so let's open, I'm gonna open something. And this is a raw image. So it's just the original image here. And let me share my screen with you again, if I can figure that out. okay, screen share, entire screen share. There we go. Okay, so let me know if you can see my screen again. And I will start editing when everybody can see it. Should be real soon. Okay, good. Okay, check the chat. Okay, so this is an, like a totally raw image from when I was in Cambodia. And this image was shot so early in the morning that there was hardly any light outside. And the tree is really interesting, but the background I did not like at all. And so I just wanted to talk very quickly about a couple things that I would do to this image to try to make it better or try to maybe just fix the background a little bit because I didn't like it. So a couple of my tools. This is my typical workflow. I have the navigator open, history open, and layers open. I have the left-hand toolbar. And aside from that, I don't really have much else open usually. So the first thing that I notice is that I don't like this background, especially in the upper right-hand corner because of how confusing it is. Like there's so much light there, so I don't like that. But I kind of also don't like how you can see like this little like pavement back here, and that makes it look too modern. And I want this to just look so mysterious. So what I ended up doing was using the background as a mechanism to make the subject stand out. What I mean by that is you could either darken the whole background so then you can't see anything distracting. In my case, I added fog to it. And the way that I did that was with my lasso tool. And with my lasso tool, I actually just went in and I started selecting, I'm gonna do this very roughly, I selected all around the tree, like exactly what I wanted to preserve in the picture. I started selecting around that and then making sure that I had these outside edges selected where I didn't want it. My workflow now is to feather this a little bit. Right click, refine edge, and take that feather slider up a bit, maybe just a little. And then I will paint with my brush just some sort of fog in the background. So I'll create a new layer. And let's say, there we go, that looks good. And I'm just going to pick a foggy color, like something that might look good as fog. Oh, and make sure my opacity's up. And then I'll just paint it in. Like really, like this is not gonna be anything good looking, trust me, but I'm just doing it. And once I've done it, I have this, ooh, yeah, that wasn't very good. I've got this sort of outline in the background. See, I made it too soft, so I might actually just step back and instead of feathering it as much as I did, I might just take that down. And instead of feathering so much, maybe I'll just do one pixel, just so it's a little bit soft in the background, and paint it in again. So this is just trial and error for me right now. Going in, seeing what looks good. And then after this, I will start to add the. So this is just getting rid of the back. That looks a little bit better. And then with a lower opacity typically, and start to paint in over the edges of the tree there, like that. Something like that maybe. Now this isn't gonna look good yet, and I'm aware, but then I can start to darken that layer if I want to. For example, I can create a curves adjustment layer, pin it down to the layer that I'm working on, and make it darker so that maybe it doesn't stand out so much. And then we have sort of a foggy background, which I really like. Another way that I try to add interest is by letting my subject stand out by manipulating the light, again with that lasso tool, just selecting wherever I think there should be more light, taking the feather up, just like that. And then another curves adjustment layer. Oops, wrong one. So this is another way that I would add some interest, by adding contrast and light to where the subject is. And the other way is to really manipulate the colors a lot. And so through curves, typically I will use, and I will go and just see what the colors need to be like and start to manipulate them a little bit there. And who knows what looks good. I'm just testing out different things, trying to see what strikes my fancy. And there, so I'll leave it there for right now. And so you guys can see just very quickly how this has changed. Just like that, by getting rid of that background. And so that's something that I do a lot. It's a common practice. I know I didn't do a fantastic job of it on this one, but hopefully that was helpful so you could see a little bit of my workflow there. And I'm gonna stop my screen sharing. Okay. Cool. Alrighty. Okay. So let's see, let's do like two more questions because I can't use up all of my internet power because my husband needs it too. So let's see. Let's see. You're watching it in the bath. I think that is fantastic. I'm not in the bath. But next time I'm totally gonna do this from the bath, but not naked. Oh gosh. Oh, Kelly's upset now. She's cringing at me. Okay. Awesome. So actually, I got a request to do a pajama party next. So I think that's gonna be fun, and we're definitely gonna do that. Okay. I'm gonna pick out two more questions. Oh yeah. Okay. Let's do this one. Thank you, Wendy, for reposting that. I appreciate it. Let's see, what tips might you have about teaching others to use visual storytelling as a method of dealing with difficult experiences? So this is a super delicate topic, and this is obviously something that I do in India. I go to India and I teach these storytelling workshops, and the point is to help people who have been through trauma to deal with that trauma and to express themselves. So I don't want to take on the responsibility of giving tips to be able to do that, because I'm not like licensed to be able to do that. I just teach what I know. And so what I do is I typically go and I will go through methods of storytelling that anybody can do, that, I mean, just any way to tell a story. And then as we continue to tell stories, like write out these stories, just continue to, like hone in on what their personal story is. So at first the stories are usually really magical or just irrelevant to anybody's actual life. And then I find that it's really awesome to say, okay, so that story was great, but now how can you add something more personal to it? Now how can you add something more personal to that? And just sort of digging in a little bit deeper with what you think is really the heart of the issue there without pushing anybody. And then allowing them to express that through emotion. Emotion is like the best thing to be able to you know, speak any language, is to say, okay, well, do we all understand this emotion? How would you portray that with your body? That can be really helpful as well. Okay, so let's see. Let's see, one more question here. Okay, so Alex is here. If you guys don't know him, you will soon. Alejandro Molina, I met this year, and he asked, how does your compassionate work with the light space influence who you are as an artist? And I really like that question, because it's sort of like a guilty pleasure of mine talking about this. And when I started working in India and working with the sex trafficking victims and those who just are very underprivileged, I started to realize that I wanted that in my life, and I hadn't really been seeking it that actively. It had just crossed my mind that I would like to do charity work with my photography if possible, and right then, it was just very serendipitous that a woman who I'm now partnered with for the Light Space contacted me and had said, will you come to India and just teach photography? So I said yes, and I developed this program that would be all about storytelling and self-expression, and I did that. And it wasn't until I did that that I actually went that I felt sort of like this responsibility and the sense of urgency to do more. And I think that's the case with anything in our lives, is that once you sort of open your eyes to a situation, you can't unsee that situation unless you block your compassionate side. And so I really wanted to sort of keep going with that. And I think that just being able to do, you know, to open a school and to do these workshops there has allowed me to gain confidence in my ability to do good work. And that has been one of the biggest eye-opening experiences for me, is that I never really saw myself as having the ability to do that. And once you just jump in and do it, then you realize that there's more and more and more you can do. And I've been on this mission ever since then to be more compassionate and to be kinder to people. And that has been just such a really great gift, I think, that I've gotten out of it. And I mentioned that you will know who Alex is soon, because he is coming to speak at my convention. So I'm going to totally throw in a plug there and say that I'll be announcing really soon the registration for the next Promoting Passion convention, which is coming up in September 27th to the 29th in Colorado Springs, Colorado. And so I'm really excited about that, and I hope that you guys can come and share time with me and everybody else. And we had such a good time last year at the first Promoting Passion convention. And I know that a lot of the people who came are also coming back, and we're all like really great friends. And it was just a really great thing. So yeah, so I hope that you guys can come, but enough of that. Let's see. No conventions in London, I don't think. I don't think I've ever worked so hard to produce anything in my life, and I don't think I could do it overseas at this point, but maybe in the future. But you come to me now, and then I'll come to you later. How about that? Let's see. Okay. Let's just do this one last question here. How do you define fine art? Because I think that's a good way to sort of end the note here. I think that fine art is literally just personal work. It's just work that you do because you love it. And I think that that is just so important to be able to do. And so when you call something fine art, it doesn't have to look a certain way. It doesn't have to, you know, express emotion or be storytelling or be surreal or anything like that. It just has to be something that comes from you that you do because it's a personal desire. And that might look like fashion. It might look like a commercial shoot, but if it comes from you, then it's fine art. So I think that that is the literal definition, and that's why I encourage everybody to jump into the fine art world to create what you want to create, because there's somebody out there who absolutely needs to hear it. There's somebody out there who needs to hear what you have to say, who wants to see your vision, no matter how difficult it is to find that person or those people who need to hear it, they're there. So keep doing fine artwork and never stop doing it, because that's a part of ourselves as artists that we need to express. So I think that I will end it there. And thank you for spending the last hour with me. I so appreciate it. I really do. And I'm just really grateful for you guys. So thank you. And I want to keep chatting. So let's see. Okay. This is my goodbye. Bye bye. Okay.